That's terrifying. Didn't do anything.
We did that last week too, didn't we?
I meant to text you earlier if you can give me the answers to the questions ahead of time so I don't look stupid this time.
Absolutely not.
Are you using a Swiffer on your face, Jimmy? Because I didn't know you were going to do me first.
That's what she said.
I knew that was coming.
That's what she said.
Good evening, weirdos, and welcome to another episode of Living Cruddy, episode 51. I'm your host, Handsome Jimmy, joined tonight by Vagino Royd, our special mystery co-host,
hi,
Vinny, and a fourth appearance, the most appearing of all the guestesses. Four times makes one whole Ziggy McNasty. Welcome, McNasty.
Why, thanks, Jimmy. It's an honor.
Indeed, isn't it? You get a smoking jacket at four appearances.
Oh, really?
Yes, you just have to buy it yourself.
I don't smoke anymore, so.
Had a cat toy thing behind you?
Yeah, it's a cat tree.
Meow. McNasty lives in a house of cats. They climb that post thing and scratch it.
I've got two here.
Oh, that's right. You imported a cat, didn't you?
Yes.
Well, the reason Vinny is here now is because Thundercunt, she's just tied down with a bunch of stuff.
Basement?
Yeah, Vinny's expansive movie and music knowledge and all the stuff that he has. We figured he'd be the perfect person to sit in that chair. So he's here for a while. We'll jump around. Thunder will be back at some point. We're just expanding our team. McNasty is back for the fourth time to tell us what the hell's going on in Mount Juliet, right?
Old Hickory.
Mount Juliet. How much do you have to pay her? I have to stop looking at Jimmy's little the new drawing of Jimmy. I have to
it's distracting.
The greatest thing I've ever. I still laugh at that. I am not an animal.
I am actually an animal.
The likeness is pretty amazing.
It is striking.
And especially that hairdo.
I'm going to superimpose it over me.
Yes. Did you watch last week's episode?
I did.
It made a couple appearances.
I'm thinking it should be the new logo. I want shirts.
I would buy a t-shirt with that on it.
Oh, I would totally wear that shirt.
That we need to get that printed like on the front of like panties. panties.
So it's been a while since Vinny was on the show. Let's reestablish where Vinny is. You're outside Harrisburg, right?
Like a minute away. There's a dirty river and there we are.
Mark lives in Harrisburg.
Manthon are the Crud's original bass player.
Well, like
he was in Mechanicsburg. Is Mechanicsburg a place?
Yeah, right down the street, matter of fact.
Okay. Vinny's always tuning in, but when were the last times you guys tuned in to the show and actually watched?
I was on a couple weeks ago.
What did you see? You know what's crazy is that fucking beard, man. I think the eyebrows are going to merge into the beard at some point. It might already be happening. I mean, you definitely have like some stuff growing into your eyes right now. Is that where that's going?
It's probably the lighting. This is the only real red part of my beard that's left. Everything else
so what we're it's not lighting, it's actual hair though. How high do you plan on letting that hair grow?
A razor hasn't touched my face in 10 years.
What would it take to break out the razor if it was like doing some creep show Stephen King shit and encroaching on your eyeballs? Would you shave that back then, or would you trim it?
No.
So explain to us the theory behind the whole beard thing. What's going on? It's just some untouchable spiritual shit, or is it?
Spiritual, really. It just hides the fact that I have no chin. You see my chin? That's my chin right there.
It looks like everybody else's chin.
If I shave the beard off, I become Yoda with big glasses.
When was the last time you saw your chin?
1993.
Wow. Oh, yeah, so your chin totally could have come back by then.
No. My chin is like this tall. Chin for just a little bit, and then neck. So it just
implant fundraiser? Is that what you were just
going to
say, Jim?
I say we get a fundraiser, raise some money for somebody, and then that goes towards McNasty shaving his beard.
I would love to see a picture without all the facial hair.
I've seen a picture, but McNasty was literally like 8 years old in that photo.
Probably.
Is there one on Facebook we can shame him with right now?
Oh, I have a photo. Yeah, we'll shame him with that one.
Or, Gino, another art project.
Huh? Yeah, well, it's different.
There you go.
Here we go.
What the monkey gosh.
Wow.
Now, I'm not laughing at the chin. I'm laughing at those fucking glasses. I'm sorry. Your chin is fine in that photo.
They're long on your head?
Yes.
The glasses are everything. And you've got like normal person glasses now. I think you could do away with the beard finally.
No, not going to happen.
Oh. I've never seen anybody so determined to hide their...
Everyone's got their thing. Mine is I have no chin and I just need to hide it.
Well, we just established you have a chin. I mean, I just saw it. Wasn't anything abnormal. I mean, it's not Vinny's chin. I mean, he's got like some power chin, like Hollywood shit or something. But
I don't even know where this comes from. Nobody in my family has.
Do you like break like rocks and shit with that thing? That's another thing we could do to raise money. Like Nasty shave his beard and Vinny will break blocks with his chin.
And I can't even grow a beard right. Not at all.
Same.
I saw you when you were in Leakin Park. You had like some stubble going.
Yeah, I've wanted something like McNasty's like a couple of years ago. Just would not do it. Comes in here and comes in here and that's that. And it just irritates the hell out of me.
You get past that thing and then it becomes a beard.
I don't know. I mean, look at this. I've been trying this for 2 freaking years.
That's all it's ever grown is that length.
Yeah.
Mine does that thing where it's like this part. It grows into 2 pieces. It becomes like a Fu Manchu.
Oh, yeah. Mine like does this weird separation thing. That's why I'm always doing this because it just naturally separates like that.
It looks like when my dog is walking away.
Yeah, that's awesome.
We'll get into some freestyle bearding here. There we go. Freestyle bearding.
All right. Well, I think we have our episode now. Okay. We had a couple things come up on the show. I wanted to check to see if McNasty or Jimmy happened to swing in during Cannibal Ferox, because that movie upset everybody. Does I know Vinny was there for a minute, but you were doing one
of your work. Yeah.
I was unable to tune in. We were in Chattanooga this weekend.
All right. Well, we played Cannibal Ferox, and it was available on the cast channel, And honestly, it had been like probably the 1990s since last time I saw it. I had forgotten just how much animal torture was in that movie. That shit is not my favorite stuff, but it wasn't as bad yet as Cannibal Holocaust, which is a movie that everybody seems to love, and I just can't stand that movie. But
I can deal with Cannibal Holocaust. I mean, I know the Blu-ray's got a version without the animal stuff, and that's the stuff I fast forward to anyway. I just think the last 10 minutes is such an impact. That's, you know, I think it's a...
The music is impactful. I mean, it's an impactful movie, but it's just taking in what they did to make that movie. Ferox did some of the same shit. They obviously killed that mongoose or tortured it to get that snake to eat it, and then they with the turtle in that movie, that obviously was the natives were
right,
they were making a meal out of that thing, so that was, they're just showing that. But they did some other shit. There was some dick slicing. Lisa was very excited about because she had missed. The scene is the guy tied to a post and they pants him, and then native cuts his dick off. They close up with this shit, and then the guy just pops it in his mouth and eats it. It's like a meal.
Are we talking like Dirk Diggler kind of thing, or
it wasn't his real penis, but it sure looked like it. I mean, they had to get somebody to play along. I know that actor has been in a ton of shit. Yeah. So I imagine he probably did not get his dick cut off in real life for that scene.
But are we talking just a regular sized prosthetic fake penis, or are we talking like Dirk Diggler,
you know, the kind you get on Amazon?
Honestly, I think that they showed his real junk in the scene at least for a second, but the one they cut off. But I mean, no, it was
how proud his family must be.
It was a large dick. I mean, what the fuck?
Oh, this is a great combo. I used to hear this Italian.
You know, those Italians, man. They don't have the Irish curse. So.
That movie was a big thing like in the 80s. You get that to rent when Wizard Video first put it out. Yeah. Under Make Them Die Slowly. And that's, you know, got to get that one. And watch it with my best friend. We're like, oh, hey, I feel pretty sick right now.
They didn't need the animal murders to make that movie. That's the part that, so we upset everybody with that movie. There's a couple of people, Sizzler, obviously, he loves torture movies. So he was probably, you know, sitting there with his pants off through that whole fucking movie. But
I would love to hear him chime in during the broadcast of this. Like, oh, yeah, no, totally.
You can tune in on probably going to be next Friday, but I'm sure he'll be watching and he'll be like, oh, dude, what the fuck? Paul was very upset, and Lisa was feigning being upset. She actually really loves animal torture. I mean, that's her thing. So then last night we switched and showed I Saw the Devil, which got a really strong response from several people. That's a pretty good movie. I thought, what do you think, Vinny? What's your opinion?
I love it. Yeah. The first time I bought it many years ago, Sudden Scenes, that hurt so much. And that was one of my purchases where I'm like, yeah, I'm glad to have this.
Fantastic. Have you ever, either of you guys seen that South Korean production, I Saw the Devil?
No. It's
kind of like a revenge flick, a little bit along the lines of the classic revenge thing that you see now, kind of like Mandy, you know, but not as extreme as that.
The villain kind of reminded me of Max Cady from Cape Fear, just a little bit.
Yeah, it was a little bit.
Are we talking about the, I think it was Lisa said something about that she thought she had the killer figured out before the end or something like that?
No, it's very clear who the killer is in this movie. Oh, they start off with him killing the person. It's a brutal movie. Everybody got real upset about the lack of practical sense that the movie made as to why the hero didn't just kill that guy. And, you know, I'm looking at it going, well, if that happened, then you don't have a movie. Yeah, the entire movie is all the shit this guy goes through allowing this guy to live so he can have this really dramatic last scene, which is fucking a mind-blowing scene in my book. You guys have never seen that. Neither one of you guys.
Highly recommend it. Definitely.
A good movie. As always, Sizzler chimed in saying he liked it. He likes anything new and flashy. And Paul couldn't stand it, and Lisa feigned being disgusted by it. So
I mean, it's one of those reasons where, and I went on this whole kick a few years ago, how, you know, we really need to watch what's going on overseas. Because this was the time when all the Japanese movies were coming out, Korean movies were coming out, and then the whole French invasion is happening. And we're sitting here, you know, making another Paranormal Activity movie, and these guys are coming out with something really original, or taking something we've already seen and just really giving us something new with it. And I still feel that way. I still feel that, you know.
Oh, America, yeah. And you saw that with Parasite, that finally got their due with that. But have you ever seen that movie, The Memories of Murder? The original one of those? It's actually a lot of parallels with I Saw the Devil. I think that they probably directly influenced that movie. So much of it plays out in I Saw the Devil and how the killer works and how they were kind of looking for him and stuff. But that movie is the original movie by that, what's the guy's name?
We Train to Busan. It's like, okay, people saw the, you know, the previews. They're like, oh, it looks like World War Z. No, it's way better than that. And it's, I think, it, you know, give a fresh new take on things we've already seen.
Oh, no, it's a well-made movie. It looks really good. Now, we watched the dubbed version, which added a layer of silliness to it.
Yeah.
I would have run the subtitled one, but not everybody likes that. So we went with it. Jimmy's just laughing. He's like, I don't know what the fuck you're talking about.
That movie I have seen. So you showed it at practice once, and then the wife and I watched.
What are we talking about? What movie?
Train to Busan.
Oh, Train to Busan. Okay.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's a good one. Train to Busan has got a little bit of the flavor. I mean, obviously, it's a South Korean movie. So, I mean, what am I talking about? But I Saw the Devil is like a serial killer movie revenge thing, which has some really disturbing shit that happens in it. There's a big guillotine thing that the guy has set up that is just like the nastiest, most head-slashing fucking piece of mechanical fucking killing machine that you've ever seen, you know? And the final scene plays out with that thing. It's a pretty shocking deal. I guess the point is I was surprised how many people didn't like that movie. I'm like, I'm thinking people are going to love this movie. And the consensus was that nobody liked it.
Well, that's many, many years ago, people would ask me, okay, Vin, what's a great horror movie to see? I'm like, well, you're going to have to look overseas. And that was always on the list. You know, I would give them a list. You know, watch this. I even told them to watch The Host, another great one. You know, and then all, of course, you know, Martyrs and Inside. That was always on the list too. So it's, oh no, I'd rather watch, you know, another Annabelle film. Oh, great. Yeah, have fun with that.
I'd rather watch the latest Freddy versus Scream.
There was I had to look it up. The Night Eats the World. We watched that while we were practicing one day. And, it, you know, we just had it on while we were practicing. I went home and I watched that. I was I really enjoyed that one.
Yeah, that's the one with the drum set, right?
Yeah. Where the set in Paris or whatever, and guy goes to a party and everyone starts getting sick and he's really drunk and he passes out and he wakes up and everyone's all fucked up and zombie. He's like last man on earth sort of thing. And
well, I think the thing that really made that one unique was all the musical shit that the guy was up to while he was biding his time. He was making all this weird music.
Setting up the Tinker toys and all that in the kitchen and drums kit and all that. That was a good one.
Yeah, no, that's a good movie.
Yeah, we had that TV when we moved to the second practice room. It was stuck on Team America World like 5 fucking months.
Well, I did change it up.
What would you do?
Didn't we watch Bloody Bible Camp or some shit?
Yes, we watched Bloody Bible Camp.
That was just like, the hell's going on? Where are we? The hell's going on over there? It just, dang it, can we start over?
Mandy was the one that fucked me up with when we couldn't hear what was going on. And we're playing really loud, and I'm like,
somebody had to explain to Jimmy what was going on in the movie. He wanted to stop.
So is that what you guys did when you practice? You just put something on and you probably like get inspired while you practice? Or
we started practicing at my house. I have a big, gigantic living room with a projection screen that's like the size of a walk-in movie theater. And we were playing there initially, and I would just roll a movie. So naturally everybody's watching the movie while we play. And then next thing you know, we stop playing and everybody's just watching the movie. Mandy was one of the things that, and the Greasy Strangler. That was where we debuted the Greasy Strangler.
That was the one I think that traumatized Jimmy like more than anything was the Greasy Strangler, which just made it even funnier and even just a greater movie.
I'm pretty sure that somebody had to drive Jimmy home that night. He'd leave his car there and get dropped off at his house.
He certainly didn't go through the car wash.
How's that?
I don't know. You tell me.
Uh-oh. It never gets old.
I drew that in Photoshop too. It was I drew it with a selection tool and then just added colors. I've never done that before. So
I screenshot. I sent it to Tiffany, but you gotta see this. It doesn't look like you, Jimmy. No, I'm not making fun of you. It's just a funny drawing. Oh,
that's dead on. That looks like not
dead. I mean, oh yeah, you could show that to anybody that say, oh yeah, that's definitely Jimmy.
The name is on it.
Well, we could cover up your name and then we could show it to your kids and they would say, yes, that's Daddy.
Name is right there.
But we'll just cover it up. See, I'm covering it up with my hand.
You know what, Gino? I want one with that, and I want to frame it and put it on the wall.
Right, I got one for you. Frankenstein. I'll try to do a new one for everybody.
Oh great.
So I can't promise that they'll be as accurate as that one, but that one was just a happy accident.
That's your Mona Lisa, buddy. It's pretty good.
All right, so let's move on to the next subject. Anybody have any questions for McNasty? That's a lot of silence.
Well, so we've been doing the short answer for like, 20 weeks
now. I know, right? So,
yeah. And you know what's funny? I always, you know, when we started doing the short answer thing, I always expected someone to ask me, what is my spirit animal?
Okay.
Right?
What is your spirit animal?
Ever asked me, what is your spirit animal? Roadkill.
Okay. Well, it should be known that, and I'm sure that everybody saw this, that we started, there's so much shit that goes into making the podcast that I get down to the end, and Vinny deals with this, Chris deals with it, Jimmy, all three of you guys deal with this shit. I'm fixated on editing. And then I'm like, oh shit, I didn't get a question for McNasty this week. So we're like manufacturing a question at that point. We'll have the dog do it, or we'll have, you know, Jimmy will do it and he'll hide his face. And then Vinny's like, oh, I got, I sent the video. Did you get to see it? I'm like, if I had time, I would have seen it. I'll see it when everybody else sees it. Definitely going to see it. And then Jimmy, of course, does what Jimmy does. He waits until the day before the show and says, oh, by the way, I didn't do Jimmy's credit cuisine.
I didn't cook really for a week and a half because I had family in town. So,
okay. Whoa. That's a big lie. You had family in town for a week and a half and you didn't cook once.
No, I did, but it was usually.
Here's the correct question. Jimmy knew he wasn't going to be able to do it and he waited until the last day to share that with me.
Slacker.
On the other side of Vinny's question, what new jam are you guys digging?
This is
for everybody, including Vinny.
Last year, number one song of 2020 was Long Violent History by Tyler Childers. That dude is a fucking genius.
Well, I'll have to check it out.
Yeah, definitely.
Like,
if it's not good, I'm going to hold you responsible.
Well, I mean, you have to appreciate Americana and, like, you know, the singer songwriter.
All right, you've totally lost me.
But long.
You said the key words.
Long Violent History was the song of 2020 for me.
So, has anybody been watching the Hulu series with Rick Rubin and McCartney?
I haven't yet, but I saw.
Me neither, yeah.
I saw a trailer for it and it's like, I need to watch that. But I'm currently binge watching another show that I got talked into watching. So it'll come later. Is it any good? Have you been watching it?
Yeah, it's really good. I think I'm on the fourth episode. It's really good. He's got him in a studio and they're playing the masters from a bunch of stuff. Everything from, you know, Beatle records up to his solo shit and Wings and all that. So it's pretty irritating, you know. Sometimes he can be a little, I don't know. His earnestness sometimes. Yeah, some people are irritated by it.
Right.
But I don't know. It's like watching a Beatle fan over-explain something, and then you realize, well, wait a minute, the fucking McCartney.
Have I told you my Rick Rubin story?
Oh. Does it involve Tower Records?
Yes. Because all of my stories with music celebrities involve Tower Records. I was helping this one guy. It was like close to closing one night. Walking him around, helping him, you know, different things he was looking for. Find this, find that. And then I had shit to do in the back room. So I left him and went to the back room. And my buddy called me back in the back room. He's like, you're never going to guess who I just rang up. And I was like, I don't know who. And he's like, Rick Rubin. Is he wearing a blue plaid shirt? Yes. I've been walking around the store 15 minutes with him and I didn't recognize him because he wasn't wearing fucking sunglasses.
Who even knows if he has eyes?
He wasn't wearing sunglasses.
You ever want to catch Rick Rubin without his beard? Watch the movie Crush Groove.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
That reminds me of the old joke. Did you hear about the new Pee Wee Herman Subway sandwich? It's called the Rubin Hold the Pickle.
No.
There's got to be a way to work Rick Rubin into that.
How many circles do you have written down? Yeah, how many circles you got?
We have that one.
Oh.
And then we're working on this one. Those are my notes.
When he's trying to think.
Yes. That's, if an idea comes to me, I'll write it down. So you see how many ideas come to me. Those are the lyrics to our next song, our next album for Jimmy.
As far as new music for me, I mean, yeah, I gotta get new dance music every 3 hours in my email. You're turning me on to some great stuff.
I don't have a whole selection of new shit. I mean, I got my old jams.
Stuff I've never heard of, and I thought I dig for everything, and just. It was an Ammo and the Sniffers. Oh my God, that's
That's my new jam is Ammo and the Sniffers.
Yeah, I mean, you know, McNasty. When you do your two first, I'm sitting there writing everything down. Gotta get that. You know, I totally missed that one.
Song Watching the Detectives. I always thought that was an Elvis Costello song. Holy shit, that's a Sam and Dave song? I mean, it was totally different from the Elvis Costello version. That kind of planted the whole seed for it. I just was like, all right, I'm just going to see if I can do a week of this. And then I made it to 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and 4 weeks, and it just kept going. And I've been doing that pretty much every day for a year now.
I don't even know what those are. I see everybody has that.
The Devo Funkos?
Funkos. A toy. It's a toy that you buy at the store, right? Everybody has like various, like Freddy Krueger's of that shit.
I got the Devo ones because like Devo rules.
You can't go wrong with Devo. Now, I've been working on this guy for 3 years now. Yeah, I have to do his other arm yet. But once I do the other arm, he will be cast, and then I will do duplicates airbrushed up.
Let me know when you get those done.
You'll do those for sale?
Oh, yeah. You never saw any of the other ones I did, Vinny?
Would this be like a figurine or?
Oh, like full-size figure or full-scale figurine.
See, now I'm like all like excited now.
Oh, I do Frankensteins. I just haven't had the opportunity or the time to do that shit.
I got this one, G.
Oh, yeah, is that a candle or is that a rubber one? Yeah. Well, there's also this guy.
I've got the candle. It's just not.
Oh, look at that one. Oh, look at that.
That's the only one left of this guy. That was the giant.
Damn it.
I sold these for $100.
Yeah.
Yes.
Glenn Strange. He's a flat backer, but you can put
it on the wall.
I've sold about 100 of these, all hand painted, airbrushed up. And then this one is actually my favorite one, but I only made about 20 of these guys.
Yeah.
One of those. And I think you sold out of them.
I made like 20 of them. They all sold in like one weekend. All right, so let's move on now to the actual questions. We're going to have a new caveat to some of this. I'm sure everybody will understand why. Count Yorga back there. The song lyrics, I don't think needs to change. But when we get to these movie quotes, I think Vinny is too much of a ringer to make available on every one of these.
Oh, come on.
We'll start off with this and just see how it goes. Jimmy will always be available, but
come on.
You get one shot at using Vinny as your lifeline. And then before we actually answer these, if you don't get them, we'll let Vinny give his answer. But so he can answer it either way. We'll handicap him a little bit on this.
All right.
As the non-PC.
Okay, let's start with the music one. I will read a couple lines from a song. You know how this works. You've done it three times.
Blah, 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 yada, yada, yada.
You tell me the following line and the name of the band and the name of the song. First one is, some say she's from Mars or one of the seven stars that shine after 3:30 in the morning.
That sounds like something David Bowie would have written, but I don't know.
Do you want to use a lifeline?
Hanson.
Fucking no. I was telling you. I was giving you all the signals.
Right, but see, these glasses aren't prescription.
Oh, right. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Ironically, all I see is Jimmy in the reflection on there. Now I see me. Are you using... You're not using the Brady Bunch screen, are you?
Who are you talking to?
I'm talking to McNasty. No, he's seeing us individually.
No, all of you guys are up above the screen.
Yeah, why am I popping in every time I speak and then Jimmy pops in every time he speaks? Jimmy.
Now it's me. See, look, there's me.
Yeah, there's Jimmy, and then here's me.
I want it back. Stop. It's me there.
Say something, Vinny.
I was going to say something, a Planet Claire.
I think Vinny's using Google over there.
I'm trying to clear something on my phone.
Okay. Yeah. We'll clarify that you can't use Google.
I know that. Yeah.
Vinny did get that right. What is the next line?
Is that Planet Claire?
Claire. I'll read the line again. You tell me the following line.
It was a guess.
Some say she's from Mars or one of the seven stars that shine after 3:30 in the morning. What's the next line?
Rock Lobster?
No. Does anybody know?
I don't.
All right, the next line is, well, she isn't.
Oh, whoops. Sorry. I'm sorry. That was an accident.
Okay, but we'll still give you the point because Vinny gave, you know how we get close. You're one for one with the help of Vinny.
Fake news, rigged election.
I just guessed.
Okay.
Wow, okay.
We're doing the next one now. The next lines are all clean fun, have another stick of gum. Man, you look better already. What is the next line? Name of the band, name of the song. All good fun, have another stick of gum. Man, you look better already.
It would help if he would sing it.
Yeah, it would help me.
You want me to give the shit away is what you want.
All right, okay.
Is that what McNasty is asking for? He's Googling shit now.
No, I'm not actually. I'm staring at a picture of a possum.
Are you disenchanted with the whole process of...
That's what I'm staring at right now.
All good, clean fun. Have another stick of gum. Man, you look better already.
It's Motorhead.
That's right. Yes. What's the next line?
Can't get the song title, but it's Motorhead.
Can any of you help him?
I can't. I don't know.
It's not Overkill, it's...
Oh, it's Orgasmatron.
No.
Orgasmo.
God fuck.
God fuck.
All good, clean fun. Have another stick of gun. Motorhead, remember me now, Motorhead.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Motorhead.
Fine. Actually, technically, I did get that because I said Motorhead.
You changed.
I didn't reference
answer.
Whether
I was like, oh, he's going away from the correct answer now.
Or the band.
Okay. All right. We'll give that one to you. But you started separating yourself from the answer. So
I did.
I think Vinny's had enough.
But I did get Motorhead.
All right. This is the most difficult one, but I have a feeling Chris might get this because it's such a profound lyric.
I am anything but profound.
The lyric is profound.
I tell everybody.
The lyric is, now we go steady to the pictures. I always get chocolate stains on my pants, and my father, he's going crazy. Eddie What's the Cochran. Next line?
Eddie Cochran. I don't know.
Eddie Cochran? What'd you say?
Eddie Cochran.
Oh,
Eddie.
He said cock.
Now we go steady to the pictures. I always get chocolate stains on my pants, and my father, he's going crazy.
I don't know.
Well, do you want help is the question.
Can I reach out to you?
No, that doesn't work. I already know the answer.
Clueless. I don't know.
So that doesn't answer my question. Do you want help from the guys?
I don't have it to give.
What about Vinny?
No, Vinny was shaking his head no as much as I was. So
the song is Dancing in the Moonlight by Thin Lizzy. And the line is, now we go steady to the pictures. I always get chocolate stains on my pants. And my father, he's going crazy. He says, I'm living in a trance. You know the song, right, Chris? Because I'm dancing in the moonlight.
Yeah.
Two of three. You still did pretty good.
What about a song about chocolate in your pants?
Yeah, well, this is not Stallions.
I want to note right now that once we get around to playing again,
you want to play this song?
No, I want to do Chinatown.
Oh, you changed.
Killer on the Loose.
Oh, Killer on the Loose. Yeah, it's one of those ones on that live record.
We need to cover a Thin Lizzy song.
I should totally do Dancing because... in the Moonlight and make Jimmy sing it. He always gets chocolate stains on his pants. I don't know.
Right now,
we're gonna go on to the movie quotes. Now, we've changed the rules on this because I believe Vinny is gonna be a ringer, not a dead ringer.
Oh, sorry.
Pick one of these for Vinny. Otherwise, if you don't get it, you have Handsome Jimmy to help you out.
Sake, you're sunk, buddy.
The first one is, around here we got something known as a Missouri boat ride. Who said that? What's the movie? I'll give you a hint. If you had TNT in the 90s and the 2000s, you would have seen this movie every other fucking week. Movies for guys who love movies.
Escape from New York and... Clint Eastwood.
Clint Eastwood was not in Escape from New York.
Yes, he was.
No, he wasn't.
Yes, he was.
You're thinking of Lee Van Cleef.
No, he was in Escape from L.A. I know what I'm talking about. I've been vaxxed.
Are you? Maybe you're talking about Escape from Alcatraz?
Oh, right.
All right. Vinny, who was it?
I have no idea.
All right.
Is it horror?
I don't know what's going on.
Is it a horror film?
Is it a horror movie?
This quote he got wrong. So okay. do you know the quote? No. Around here, we got something known as a Missouri boat ride.
I was going to say Roadhouse.
Okay, no.
Ben Gazzara and Roadhouse.
Yeah, it was Clint Eastwood, but it was the Outlaw of Josie Wales.
Do I get half credit because I was because I jokingly said Clint Eastwood?
I will give you half credit. What does it matter? You can't use this at Shoney's either way. So let's move on to the next
Shoney's
one.
Shoney's has bars now.
Can't use it there either.
Are you afraid of spiders? Are you afraid of rubber spiders? Are you afraid of rubber spiders on strings? Man, you are one scared cat.
I have no clue.
Oh, look at Vinny's all about the impractical jokers.
Yeah. All right, Vinny.
No idea.
You.
I know.
You're written out of the will, my friend. You're written out.
Well, okay, so I'm such a snob. I don't think this is a great line.
But it's such an easy, recognizable line. Are you afraid of spiders? Are you afraid of rubber spiders? Are you afraid of rubber spiders on strings? Man, you are one scared cat.
Oh, I know it. It's shit. Is it Little Reggie in Friday the 13th Part 5?
It sure is.
Ah, look at that!
Thanks, Vinny. Thank you, brother.
I just watched it 2 weeks ago. Yeah. Saw it in theaters.
And while we're on that, I would like to say that is one of the more was underrated movies of the...
Was that Liam?
No.
Bloody finger.
That's the other one.
Oh. cross your fingers. I'm going to try to get Melanie Kinneman.
We can ask her about the incredible disappearing wet sweater. She's running through the woods. Her clothes change continually. Like the shirt goes away, then it comes back.
If you watch a movie enough times, you'll start to notice all the editing mistakes.
There's one in Soylent Green, which where the guy, he's controlling at the very end, he's controlling the machine, and he switches the knobs from left to right, and there's like some patch cords that just disappear right off the fucking screen.
They're there, and then they're not there.
All right, so Vinny got you Reggie from Friday the 13th, 5, A New Beginning, which in my book is definitely more underrated and gets less credit than a lot of people. I like it better than 3. I think so.
I don't think I've ever seen 5.
It's a unique one. It's got some real characters. It has more bodies in it than any of the other movies.
Yeah, lots of kills. Lots of kills.
My favorite Jason kill in any of the Friday the 13th movies was when he picks up the chicken or whoever in the sleeping bag.
Yeah.
Like, boom, bam, 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 bam. It's like,
it was a good scene in a terrible movie.
My favorite is part 3 in 3D in the theaters with my dad. And I'm 11 years old. And Jason's squeezing that dude's head. And this eye flies out. My dad spit his soda all over the place, laughing his balls off.
The 3 is a good one too. All right, let's move on to the last one here. 3 of 5. Do this one, you'll do better than breaking even. The quote is, "The chain in those handcuffs is high tensile steel. It'd take you 10 minutes to hack through it with this. Now, if you're lucky, you could hack through your ankle in 5 minutes. Go."
That's Saw.
I can stop you there. It is not Saw.
It is not Saw?
"The chain in those handcuffs is high tensile steel. It'd take you 10 minutes to hack through it with this. Now, if you're lucky, you could hack through your ankle in 5 minutes. Go."
Okay, you can see where I went with the ankle.
Oh, yeah. No, there's a very similar scene in Saw, but that quote doesn't happen.
I don't know. Jaws 3D.
I don't remember the handcuff scene in that.
I don't know. Was there a handcuff scene in Behind the Green Door?
Probably. I only watched 10 minutes of that. You have lifelines. Oh, here we go.
That's my lifeline.
Cheech and Chong Up in Smoke.
Are you going with that, or are you going to reach out to one of these guys?
Analyzing the faces, Jimmy looks scared. Benny looks scholarly but unsure.
That's a good description.
Can you give me a hint?
1979, I think. Does not happen in the United States.
I'm going to hate myself for not knowing it, too. I'm going to have to fold.
Fold, huh? Okay. It was Mad Max. Yes.
Should have known that one.
When the guy is handcuffed to the car before he blows up.
Was it with Johnny?
I think his name was Johnny.
Yeah.
It was one of Toe Cutter's crew. Yeah.
Damn it.
So Chris did, or I'm sorry, McNasty did.
Chris McNasty.
Yeah, it's just like Mike Dharma and Donald Roser.
Yeah.
So you did half of them. That's pretty good.
Better than I did last time.
I'm sorry, I let you down. I'm sorry.
Well, you got the Motorhead one, so you didn't blow Motorhead this week.
I did not. I cave on the Motorhead this time.
He blew Motorhead at our last
week. I did. There was a car passing by after we finished the last one, and I almost jumped in front of that car because I missed the
out of shame.
It gets worse now because we have
Nad Libs.
Now that I'm writing this, it's a whole different approach. There's a lot more of the words. The story steers itself. When Joe did it, he basically steered the story and had very little words. We're letting you decide whether this is funny or not.
No pressure.
Now, what I'll do is I'll take the words for you, then I'll send it to Jimmy and he can read it. He's the best at that. So you remember how this works?
Yeah.
All right.
Really quick, Jimmy, you know this? Do you know this? Funny.
Plural noun.
Bourbons.
Any country.
Scotland.
Any number.
6.
A hobby.
Woodworking.
An 80s movie.
Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
An adverb.
Quickly.
Adjective.
Brightly.
A number.
6.
Is it always going to be 6?
Yeah.
9.
A magical term.
Amazing.
Adjective.
Bright.
A celebrity.
Johnny Cash.
That's a good celebrity. A shitty band.
The Creeping Cruds.
That's
not cool.
You're making fun of
it's
Jimmy.
Humbling.
Another shitty band.
Danzig.
Fist of the North Star.
Wow. KD doesn't watch this anyway.
No, he doesn't.
A type of guitar.
Gretsch.
A verb.
Shitting.
Shitting?
Yes.
A 70s song.
Mandy.
We did that last week.
Mandy.
Mandy.
Mandy. All right. An animal. Plural.
Giraffes.
Giraffes.
Why are you smirking, Jimmy?
Another animal.
Platypus.
Rabbits.
I said platypus.
A platypus? Is that a platypi?
Platypi.
Platypussies.
Platypussies.
Oh, Jesus.
A past tense verb.
Killed.
Adjective.
Brightly.
A famous musician.
Merle Haggard.
A nonsense word.
Psycho alpha disco beta bio aqua do loop.
Oh, come on.
Type it in there, Gene. Come on.
Jimmy has to read it, so give me a noun.
Bottle.
A name ending in A.
Omega.
Omega is a name. A nasty liquid.
Bile.
An item of clothing. We're almost done.
Shirt.
An extreme adjective.
Gary Cherone.
Smashing. Smashing.
Another extreme adjective.
Syphilis infected.
Are we handing this off to Vinny to finish your story?
Yes.
A false rock band. A terrible band that does not rock.
You too.
An outer space word.
Onomatopoeia.
How is that an outer space word?
Captain Kirk.
Not a word, but we'll use it anyway.
Thank God I'm drunk.
We're all going to be drunk by the time this shit's over.
I got to be sober for this.
An adjective. This is the last couple right here.
What am I looking for?
An adjective. The same thing that stumped you a minute ago. Yeah.
Green.
A creature from The Hobbit.
Handsome Jimmy Hansen.
He's not in The Hobbit.
Mason Reese.
Okay, me.
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 A creature from The Hobbit. Me.
So, it's a McNasty? A number.
Six.
Of course.
Again. Three sixes.
An animal.
Giraffe.
Again.
You already used that.
Why can't I use it again?
Because you're drunk.
This clam.
Okay, penguin.
A gross beer brand.
Bud Light.
And finally, a body part.
Taint.
That's much better.
Here we go. Get ready for hilarity.
Oh, wait. How many times have I said no?
Oh, I gave up a long time ago.
I've never been more aware of how many times I say aware.
We're going to have to start having lifelines on NadLibs when McNasty's on.
Taco. McNasty saves rock and roll.
I do not save rock and roll.
Fed up with the never-ending void of music due to years of COVID lockdown, McNasty decided to sell all of his bourbons and move to the remote forests deep in the country of Scotland. McNasty would indulge a six-year period of isolation, self-reflection, and here he would finally learn the fine art of woodworking and recite all the dialogue from Ferris Bueller's Day Off. One day, as he quickly walked the frightening forest near his hobbit hutch, he spotted a small figure wandering deep inside the woods. He followed the figure for 6 days before finally approaching him on the pinnacle of Amazing Mountain. There before him stood the sparkling, bright visage of the great Malcolm Young. Malcolm raised his palms to the sky, fixed his eyes on McNasty, and spoke, "McNasty, my time in rock and roll has passed, but I have special magical skills to pass along to you that I want you to use to save the world from the evil Johnny Cash, the Creeping Cruds, and the Fist of the North Star." Suddenly, a Gretsch appeared before them. McNasty carefully held the instrument and began shitting. Like a heavenly harp, the opening chords of Mandy emanated from the guitar and filled the woods. Many creatures, such as giraffes and platypuses, appeared from the forest and began to dance. McNasty killed and levitated them in a rightly puff of smoke as he was whisked away to a magical place. McNasty gained his footing and struggled to identify where he was. He thought for sure he was going to appear in a smoke-filled stage, flanked by Merle Haggard, Angus Young, and Bon Scott. Instead, as the dying mist cleared, he realized he was actually a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. On the surface of the planet, Psycho Elephant Disco Babe Quadu Lupe.
Psycho Alpha Disco Bayo Bio Aquadulu.
In the middle of the Sith Wars, McNasty reached for his bottle saber to defend himself against Ermerger. The Hutt, who was rushing him from the one side, and Jar Jar Dinsky, who was covered in bile-filled COVID sores, rushing him from the other. His saber was not to be found. Instead, he had that ridiculous guitar sticking out of his shirt. He straddled the guitar and immediately went into a smashing, McNasty version of AC/DC's TNT. It went something like this, you motherfucker. Because I'm McNasty. I'm dynamite. I'm McNasty. And I win my fight. McNasty. I'm a power load, McNasty. Watch me explode! And just like that, McNasty exploded. Like syphilis-infected Death Star, killing all the Darth Siths and the Jawas, as well as the remaining members of U2 and, of course, Jar Jar Dinks. Though McNasty Skywalker was now dead, he had indeed saved rock and roll and all the members of the starship Captain Kirk. Nowadays, down at the local pub, the Green McNasty, they still sing songs of McNasty. And every Thursday, they offer 6 penguins wings for $1 and all the Bud Light you can slam down your taint. God bless McNasty.
Thank you for saving rock and roll.
Cheers.
How do you pronounce giraffe?
Yeah, what is that giraffe shit?
You mean giraffe?
Giraffes were my grandmother's favorite animal, which is why I always default to giraffes.
Giraffe.
Yeah, because I like leons and tigers, you know.
Tigers.
Leons and tigers?
My there favorite it is. Person on the planet.
That's for sure.
It was.
Thank you for reading that so well, Jimmy.
Hey, it's my pleasure.
And thank you to McNasty for saving rock and roll.
Yes, thank you.
I haven't saved shit. I haven't saved shit.
So what we found out about McNasty since COVID started is that he's a all-down drunk.
Full-blown alcoholic.
Is there a Jimmy's Credit Cuisine this week?
Not yet, but there will be.
There will be. Okay.
Hey, holy shit, we're making a fucking cheesecake.
This guy seems incredibly interesting.
Okay, we got some butter. We got some sugar.
Butter, sugar.
We're going to put it together
okay.
with some fucking graham
Why
crackers.
Why is he cursing?
We're going to throw them into the chopper machine.
Uh-huh.
And,
okay.
And
then he's putting a bunch of shit in it.
Good. We're going to get the
thing there. That's weird.
Out. Then we're going to slap it into this spoon
wow.
pan.
Wow. Does look, that looks
paper,
really good,
butter
though.
In the bottom. We're going to smash
like,
it down. Sometimes I like to use my
grandma crackers.
What do you call it? The meat tenderizer. Smash it in
uh-huh.
there real good.
Then poundy, poundy.
We got some sour cream. I got some salt.
Oh,
I got some vanilla.
Yeah.
I got some.
Is there?
Two
I thought
things,
this was
three
a cheese.
Four things, five, six,
cake.
Six fucking things of
wow.
sour cream cheese.
Wow.
Jesus Christmas.
Wow.
And
we
got seven whole eggs and 2 egg yolks. Ooh.
Why so many eggs? That's a lot of egg,
cheese.
Right?
We're gonna teach
okay.
this fucking
okay.
cream cheese a lesson. We're gonna beat
oh,
it
yeah.
up real good.
That's
we're gonna add some sugar.
Dog.
You like the sugar? Yeah. Put the white powder
some
in there.
Labor.
That's right. We love the white
oh,
powder.
Oh, yeah, I see.
We're going to mix it
okay.
around.
Okay.
We're going to teach
this is
that
taking a long time.
To. We're going to beat the living hell out of it.
Why is it taking so long?
Then we're going to slowly add one at a time.
Is that dog
please.
Eating cheese?
One at a time, adding those eggs. You get your... Yeah,
eggs
sorry,
are disgusting.
Okay. No, they still got more egg, but there we go. We add to get the... Egg, one at a time, thank you. It's hard to get good help these days. These fucking kids with their video games. And then we put the salt, we put the vanilla in there to make it taste real good. We're gonna boil some water. I got a kettle. I'm gonna boil some fucking water and get it real hot. We gotta turn that fucking oven on.
What,
350
tea?
Degrees.
I don't
oh,
understand.
That's gonna be good. Yep. Preheating.
Right.
Very good.
The fuck
then
does this guy
talk
real long?
Right at the top of the crust.
What?
We're not baking the crust first. Fuck that. We're
no.
gonna put the goo right in the crust.
You should really
right
shut up.
Goo, right
no,
the top.
Seriously, you're
Makes
being
it
a.
Real good.
What?
That's right. Get all the goo. Slap it
I was
in there.
Thinking about the eggs.
Spread it around.
I don't know.
That's good. Okay, then what? I'm gonna pour that boiling water on the sides there, because we want it to.
Oh, there's the boiling water.
Nicely
baked.
Okay, like
I get it.
Not a custard.
The fuck you talking about?
Holy
what?
Motherfucking
Why don't you
shit,
shut up?
That looks beautiful.
What?
Oh,
why don't you shut
so
up and listen?
Oh, look at that.
Huh?
Oh, you gotta be kidding me.
Oh, wow, that's
fucking
awesome.
Oh my
what?
God.
What?
That's a ridiculous cheesecake right there. There's a shortbread too. Yeah.
What?
Stupid.
Right? Right?
What?
Hey there, everybody. It's McNasty with my new segment, Earworm of the Week. This week I've chosen to start this new endeavor with a song that I like to call the Old Man Anthem of the Decade. It's Danko Jones' The Kids Don't Want to Rock from their 2011 album called Mouth to Mouth. It's a rocker. You should check it out. I'll post a link to the song on the Freakout page after this airs. In the future, I hope to be able to just provide a link right here, or a little segment of the song, but I'm not quite good with the video editing yet, but I'm working on it. So check out the song, Rock On.
Well, hey, everybody. Monster Minute on the road in a much safer location. Here we are in busy Baltimore. There's a hospital over here. There's a college over here. And we're right here at Westminster Hall. It's a nice little church here, and I actually DJed a wedding here. But most importantly, what's more fun and more historical, the gravesite of Edgar Allan Poe. Now, all of us here, we're all fans of the Roger Corman Poe films. But my favorite, it's got to be Pit and the Pendulum. And it's also my very first Vincent Price film. If you're ever in Baltimore, check this place out. You're really going to love it. There's some catacombs under here, a lot of creepy grave sites, and you can stay away from all the danger. You might have to dodge a needle or two, but hey, it's worth it. See Edgar Allan Poe's grave.
I asked you earlier, and you were like, I've had my family in
town was
for a week and a half, and I haven't paid shit. I was like, you're a liar, and you're a slacker.
That was my excuse for the last time.
The standard stock footage of the microwave and the hard-boiled egg thing?
Yes.
Yeah.
So that's shit that I had to put together to salvage Jimmy's credit cuisine.
I know, because Jimmy's a slacker.
Yes.
Man, like alcohol is a truth serum for McNasty. He wants to check in with you real quick.
Hi. What up?
Yourself there?
Hey!
What up, bro?
Hey, is that Liam?
That's yeah, Liam. He's older.
All right, man.
Welcome, welcome.
What the heck?
See that?
That's Jimmy.
That's me.
Jimmy looks like Jimmy got a lot smarter. he's got a big brain now. My sister has no respect for you people.
He's too nice to do that to you guys. Yeah, so. Yeah. But you guys can't tell him to get a shower, but he probably won't do that.
Yeah, I was planning on getting a shower.
We're going to have him do his own segment now.
That's Vinny.
There you go.
That's Vinny.
Well, thanks for joining us, weirdos. We want to thank our fantastic co-host for the evening, Vinny. Always handsome, looking good. Vagino Roy joining us again. And our fantastic guest, McNasty.
Thank you for saving rock and roll, McNasty.
Yes, we appreciate it. And you.
When I passed you in the doorway, well, you took me with a glance. I should have took that last bus home, but I asked you for a dance. Now we go steady to the pictures. I always get chocolate stains on my pants. And my father, he's going crazy. He says I'm living in a trance. But I'm dancing in the moonlight. It's got me in its spotlight. It's alright. Dancing all right. In the moonlight. On this long, hot summer night.